Okay, so yeah, looks good. Yeah, I forgot to disable the sound because I didn't find any way to put the chat outside. Okay, so just do this. We'll do this. I just need chat. Okay. Shit. Okay, so I will do another way. This. Great. Perfect. Yes, that would be a good idea, but I can't do anything on the stream. Side streaming. Okay, so we'll start. I think most people should be here right now. We have 10 spectators. I will check the users. So who is there? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So here's the summary. We'll start to set up the project in order to be able to script in Pokémon SDK. So with various sub-steps that I will mostly skip, I will just give you some hints. And after, we'll check how the scripts are structured. So there is a specific structure in PSDK. We have to respect that. So it will be greatly done. And after, I will show you how to create a new script, and then how to create a scheduled task. And after, the most important things is the monkey patch, basically editing a script that is basic in PSDK, but you don't edit directly the PSDK base. You add your modification from another script. Okay, so let's start with installing the project in order to work with PSDK scripts. So first of all, we'll need to install Visual Studio Code. I assume you already have Pokémon SDK on your computer, so you just search Visual Studio Code. The code is really important in the name because Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code isn't the same software. So you won't be able to do the same thing. And then you click on download. I think it will download and you just need to install. Once you get Visual Studio Code installed, you will need to install Ruby. So you will search for Ruby installer on Windows, and you download the one that is Ruby plus Dev Kit, so you have everything to work with Ruby. So I won't also download it because it's already installed on my computer. And then, once you installed Ruby, we'll run a new terminal and we'll write gem install solar graph. So this command aims to install the linter we use in PSDK in order to have the ints, the type of the objects and stuff like that. And then it will take a bit of time because the gems are all overloaded. In the meantime, you can install SolarGraph on the Visual Studio side, Visual Studio Code. So you go on extensions, you search SolarGraph. You have Ruby SolarGraph, it's that, and you click on install. It's already installed on my site, so I don't need to install it. Okay. And then yeah, it's installing some stuff. I don't know what is those thing. Maybe I'm actually updating it. Once it's installed, we'll assume it's already installed on my side. We'll run a new terminal in administrative mode. It's really important. Then we open CMD. And we go to the project folder. So in this side, it will be for me this one. So you write cd this. Since it's not on the same drive, you have to change the letter. You see that I'm on the folder, so that's okay. And then we'll move to Pokemon SDK. Scripts. Okay. I forgot a letter. Okay. So usually you don't have this folder because it's not versioned. So we'll just write the command mkdir my script. I will double check that it's correct. So I use gitignore. And I check it's my script with an S. Okay, so we have created a folder we will use in Visual Studio Code in order to be able to make our custom scripts. And on this script, we'll make a dynamic link between a virtual script folder here and this script folder. So I will show you the command, and that's why we have to be administrator. So you write mklink slash d, the name of the folder. Wait, I forgot to move to the folder. So mklink slash d, name of the folder. So we'll call it script. And then the relative path. So you have to be careful. We use anti-slash and not slash. So 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, and then we write the name of the folder. So it says the symbolic link has been created. So if we get this there and we go on Pokemon SDK scripts, my scripts, you see it's a link, but when you watch on the Explorer, we didn't go to the actual link. It's like if we are in the same folder, which is great because that's what we want in order to be able to use this folder in Visual Studio Code. So to show you that those two folders are actually the same, I will create a folder. Okay, and move everything inside it. And you see that the same thing happened in the two folders. Hey. So, now, we will be able to move on the second part. Fuck. I did a mistake. I have to wait because the extension is being reinstalled. So, like you see there, it's written Nokogiri is built. So that means we need the dev kit in order to be able to build some dependencies. So be really careful when you install Ruby. If you don't install all the things, it won't work. And then we are waiting. Yeah, I should have put the no doc argument. Yeah, that's not easy for a French guy to speak English. We don't have the same accent. Okay, so now it's totally installed. So I should be able to open Visual Studio Code. And then, I don't know if you see it. Just checking quickly. A bit, okay. So, I will just check if it has been started. Yeah. So, you see in the bottom of the screen, it's written starting the Solar Graph language server. No, Ruby is really easy to learn. I will show you a bit of Ruby code when we create the script on PSDK. Before I do the theory of PSDK, and then we move on the actual Ruby scripting. Okay, so it says that SolarGraph is ready. Yeah, your sentence makes sense. Okay, so as you may see, if I put the mouse on fixed scales, it shows us what fixed scales is supposed to return. So I didn't write return, so it assumes that the last line is the return type. And it also shows the description. That can be really useful when you program. And you can do also a lot of stuff. If you start writing fix, you see that it suggests all the possibilities, which is great. So, now we'll move on how the scripts are structured. So, in PSDK, hello Martinez, there is two or three different folders. I will just answer the question about Visual Studio Code. So we use Visual Studio Code because it's free, basically. It's free and it works. Because if you use Visual Studio, you are supposed to pay it, at least if you make a professional use of it. And extensions like IronRuby and stuff like that are basically not free. Yeah, and also Visual Studio Code works with a lot of language. I can show you this file. Basically, it's a YAML file that describes all the rules I'm enabling or disabling on PSDK. And it does the linting. So, why don't we use Atom? Basically, I don't use Atom because 3 years ago, there was absolutely no compatible Ruby language server on Atom, on Windows. You had to use Docker, which is bad because Docker doesn't work on Windows. Or you need a professional version of Windows, which is expensive. So I used something that actually worked. And since they had 2 years of they were later from 2 years, we don't use Atom. But if you want to use Atom and you can use Atom for that, that's okay. You can do it. Yeah, Docker is practical, but yeah, it makes some stuff really painful. Even more when you try to install something like Discourse on your website, you can't because you need Docker, and Docker is not supported by most of the web hosts. And also the virtual private servers are really expensive compared to the simple web host. So let's continue on the structure of PSDK. So we have three sections. This one, the PSDK script. You should never edit any script there unless you are trying to make PSDK better and make a merge request. Putting aside this folder because it's ignored by PSDK. This is the first script that are loaded. So everything that is overwritten somewhere else will be overwritten. You have the scripts folder in the root of your folder, of your project, sorry. This one is for your custom scripts. It follows the same rules as the PSDK script. So you need to create a file name that is a Ruby file and start with 5 digits, followed by a space and the name, and then .rb. For the folders, it's the same, 5 digits, followed by the name. This helps PSDK to load the script in the right order, because on Windows or on Linux, the order of the script can be different and it can lead to incompatibilities. Okay, so this is where we'll make our script, but since we will use Visual Studio Code, we will make our script there in the script folder. So since I moved everything in subfolders, Visual Studio Code thinks it's better to do like this. So you can just basically click on script and then create a new file and it will work. So, and the last part of the PSDK scripts are the RMXP scripts. You can get them from there. And that's all the script you put there. If you are used to RMXP, you can use this, but you will lose all the benefits of Visual Studio Code. So we basically don't recommend to use that. Okay, so now we'll see the internal structure of the Pokemon SDK folder. We have those folders that are numbered, and we have those scripts. So basically, the Ruby scripts are loaded before the folders. So the order is the scripts in the order that is said there, and then the folder in the same order. And you see that some folders has subfolders, and we will load this script first, and then those folders. And then we load the scripts inside the folder. So there is a logical structure in PSDK. So we have the script from RPG Maker XP. Basically, this one should not be modified a lot, and they will probably disappear one day. I don't know. There's a map system. That's basically the map engine and the event engine. So I decided to put it there because since the scripts are really complicated, we split them in various parts. So you see there's game character 1, that is some global informations. You have game character passable, that is only the function that checks if a character can move on a specific tile. And since there's the bridge, there's surf and stuff like that, like you have to follow me and a lot of other stuff. We have a lot of methods for that. It's really more complicated than basic RMXP paceable function. And we have also the move function, the turn function, the appearance function, the states. There's nothing there. The follow me section. And the things that has been added by PSDK, like a front tile event, front name check, and stuff like that. And then we have the PSDK addition. So basically, you see there's the scheduler, the event task, and a lot of scripts. So those two scripts will be removed in the future. This script will be removed. And the other should remain there because that's utility scripts. And then we have the event interpreter. So that's not the RMXP interpreter, that's all the function we added in PSDK. So if you want to search for a function from PSDK, you check on those scripts and you will find the source code. Otherwise, you go on the documentation, PSDK doc, you search for interpreter. And then you have all the functions, but this documentation is not always up to date. So sometimes some functions are missing. For example, this one, receive Pokémon sequence, or start trainer battle and trainer A sequence. That helps you to make a trainer event with only two or three Ruby command. Which is way faster than making the events. Okay, so then we have the game data. Basically, that's all the data that has been edited by Rubyhost or by you, because there are some constants. For example, the daycare constant that gives you all the Pokémon that are not breeding, the Pokémon that can't breed with Ditto, the group that is not able to breed. The rate, depending on if you are holding the oval charm or not, and if it's a group in common or not, and the baby variations. So, for example, Nidoran can basically makes a male or female version of this, and because in the past, that was the only two male and female Pokémon that are different. We need a variation for that, and that's the same for Tauros and Miltank, and also Volbeat and Illumise. And there is also the instance data and a lot of informations. So you see that. The data is separated from the rest. For example, there we have the PFM module, which is basically the manipulation of all the information about PSDK. Sorry, I read the chat. And in there, you will see the logic for the Pokédex that gives all the information for the player. So all the Pokémon he saw and the forms, all the Pokémon he captured, the number of time he captured a specific species, the number of time he fought a specific species, and maybe in the future we'll add some information there. And that's the same there. That's the Pokémon party that is holding all the information about the game, so the actors, which are the Pokémon, the Pokédex, the bag, the trainer, which is the player, the storage, which is the computer, the environment, which tell it's raining, it's snowing, you are walking on a grass tag and stuff like that, the wild battle manager, which gives you the Pokémon you will see, and a lot of other information. Then we have the UI folder. This is where we will define every piece of graphic for PSDK. For example, we have I will find that. Helper sprites. Basically, you have a class inside there that is type 1 sprite. And if you give a Pokémon to this object, it will show the type 1 of the Pokémon with the correct picture. And we use that with the sprite stacks. So if we search about this one, you see that in the memo we added this. So we push a sprite at a certain position with no image, and we use type 1 sprite. So when we'll set the Pokémon of this interface at this position, you will see the type 1 of the Pokémon, and on this position you will see the type 2 of the Pokémon. Okay, and then after that we have the gameplay module. So the gameplay module is basically all the scene of PSDK, so the Pokédex scene, the summary scene, the party menu scene, and the menu scene. So that's, I will say that's the logic and what calls every UIs that has been defined. So if we check one of the last script menu, so we have a basic generation. We store all the instance variable that gives us the state of the scene, and then we have the create graphics function that will do several stuff, like creating the background. So in our case, creating the background is basically copying the bitmap of the map and applying a blur effect. And then we also have the create button function that is called, and you see there we create something that comes from the UI module, the UI module, sorry. And if you click there and click on go to definition, you see the definition of a menu button. So basically a menu button is an icon with a background and a text. And from that we have the animation of the icon. In the last version of PSDK, the icon did nothing, and now the icon is moving when you are on the option, which is nicest. Okay, and the rest is basically the battle engine, and it's not really important. Okay, so we have finished with the structure. We'll move to another part, that is how to create a new script on PSDK. So I already spoiled a little how to create one, but I will repeat. So you go to the scripts folder, you can do it there, it also works. You have the script, no, it wasn't updated. So you can also do it on the root script folder. So you can create a new file like this. So we give a number with 5 digits, and we'll give a name. For now it's not important. .rb. Okay. So it should refresh. If it doesn't, we click on this button. Okay. And then you see we have our first script that has been created. Then we need to check if the script is working on PSDK, because sometimes you can make mistakes, wrong numbering and stuff like that. So if you want to make sure that the script you added works, basically write this command, system pause, save, and if you launch Pokémon SDK, you just wait a little. Okay, you see the game stopped, and it says press a key to continue, which means our script has been loaded, but this one does nothing. So then from that we will be able to start with the Ruby basis. So for that I will need you to ask some questions. And I will just do some basic commands, and I hope that will be useful for you. So, from our first script, we will start by creating some variables. In Ruby, we have various types of variables. The local variable that start. What is that? Okay. Okay, we have the local variables that start with any letter that is not a capitalized letter or a symbol. So A equals 0, B equals 1. And if we want to display something in the terminal, we use the command put, which means put string. And then we write A plus B, so that's basic math, and we'll see that the result is 1. If we change A to 2, we see that the result is 3. So we just go there, we will open cmd.bat, it's easier, and we run game. And then we wait. You see, it has returned 3 here, which is great. We have another kind of variables, that is the instance variable. So for that, I will not show it in this script. I will show it in the menu button. So the instance variables are the variables that start with the arrow base symbol. So those variables are stored in the object that is created. And this allows you to write the logic in a class and to fetch the value. And it allows you also to have two different entities that shares the same variables names, but not the same content, because that's two different entities. So that's why we use instance variables. And also, something I didn't say about local variables. So you see there, you have a variable that is called value. It doesn't start by a symbol. It doesn't start by a capital letter. So it's a local variable. And if you go on the select equal functions, the variable value exists, and it's a Boolean. But if you go on the update function and you write value, it doesn't exist, and you see that it doesn't know what type is value. So if you write 1 there and we write value there, no, here it says it's an integer. But if we go there, it says that it's a Boolean, which means that those two variables are not linked. But those two variables are linked because they are instance variable. Okay, so on the next step, we have also the global variables. So the global variables start with a dollar sign, and we use usually actors, which is the party, so all your Pokemons. And you see that we usually do a lot of stuff with actors. And even in game, when you play on the game, so we load the game. Okay, it's loaded. And then we load the party. You see there, I have a Pikachu, a Muse, and a Mew. If I access the actors variable, it shows us we have a Pikachu, a Meowth, and a Mew. And if we add something in this variable, actors, we create a new Pokemon. Let's say this one. Okay. And if we check, we have a new Mew. But this one is level 18. So the global variables are accessible everywhere. We don't recommend using them, except for some stuff like referring to the party, to the Pokédex and stuff like that. But otherwise, always use instance variable or local variables. Then we have another kind of variable that's basically the constants. And this is important for the next part, which is the monkey patch. So we have a constant here that is named basic coordinates in a capital letter, and it gives the coordinate of the button, actually the first button. So if you want that will not work, Edge. If you want to move the button but not change the whole script, instead of rewriting this method, we will create a new script. This one is first script. We will copy the definition and we will remove this part because we don't need to recall to remind Ruby that this one is a spirit stack, and then we remove the old variable if you want to remove it, or you can do dot clear because it's an array, so you can clear the array, and then you can make the x coordinate will be this one, and the y coordinate will be we will keep that. So we used a specific method to modify this variable, but remind that there is a lot of methods. This one is not the best. Actually, it's the worst of all. There is another method that is basically just you remove the variable and then you change the coordinate. This one is a bit more explicit, so I will do something worse. I will use this number so you will clearly see that the menu has moved. So if we test, okay, we open the menu, you see that the menu is not at the right place, because we change the coordinate, and the game doesn't complain about that, which is great. So let's say we want to do something else. We don't want to change the coordinates, but we want to remove the icon animation because we don't like that. So we in this case we will have to change a lot of things. So you see that the logic is stored inside update and inside selected equal. You see that if the button is selected, the icon angle starts with the angle variation. So what we will do, we'll put angle variation at 0. So remove const angle variation equals 0. And then we'll just redefine the update method to make it do nothing. And you see that the indentation broke, so we just fix it. And we put a commentary, because otherwise RuboCop is not okay with us. So we save, and then we test. We open the menu, and you see that the icon is not animated anymore, which is what we wanted. Now, we'll see the monkey patch, the real monkey patch, because right now we just modified some stuff. So I just need to find a script where we can do a monkey patching. I don't know which one right now. Gameplay. Let's say we. Yeah, let's say we want to change how the menu background is shown in the menu script. So we'll copy the definition there. We remove this. And then we will patch the function. It's there. Okay. So the function we want to patch is create background. So it's there. It's a private method, so you can make it private, so you are sure that some stuff we don't will not break internally. Private. And then we'll monkey patch this function. To do this, we use the alias keyword old create background create background save. And then, if I'm not wrong, I just need to check. Okay, and then we just redefine the function. In Ruby, private and protected is the same thing. But if you do real oriented programmation, you will use protected. But Ruby, I will fix that later if it's needed. But right now, I'm not sure. I don't know what protected does in Ruby, so I prefer using private. It's explicit. So we recreate the method. We call the original one. And then we will reverse the background. We'll do this background dot error equal true. Doesn't know the content of background. Yeah. Okay. So you see in this case, it didn't achieve to find the type of the background. So we'll force it. We'll tell type shaded sprite, and then doesn't work. We'll use sprite because it's a bit the same thing. Oh, I know what's the problem. I think I lost something. I will just do this. Okay, so sometimes we lose the linting. That's weird, but why not? I think I need to put it there. Yeah, I need to put it there and it will work. Okay, it works. And that's the right function. So, yeah, because I use the set bitmap that returns basically that returns self and it doesn't know. So when you do this, make sure you type your variables. So this way, it says it's a shaded sprite. We are using the right property. So if I start the game, you will see a magic trick. Okay. We start the game. We open the menu. And it's reversed. Which means that everything worked properly. So you see there that it's not blurred, and the problem is that in fact there, that's transparent pixels. So when we take a screenshot of a viewport, those pixels remains transparent. So you see there it's transparent, and the blur effect tried to blur the transparent pixels there. And as you see, I removed my modification, so the icons are now animated like normal. Okay, so that's the basic stuff you will do when you edit PSDK scripts. Basic monkey patch, and then that works. And then, yeah, I skipped the scheduled task, but I think it's a bit too complex right now. Basically, I will just show you what is a scheduled task. So we have this script that is called PSDK tasks. And in fact, PSDK has a scheduler that allows to run code at different points of the game. For example, when you start to teleport your player to another place, this line, those lines of code will be executed. So it will remind the old player position, the old player ID, and a lot of stuff. Then there's another function that basically stores all the position of the follower relatively to the player. So when you teleport from an exterior map to another exterior map, the follower will be teleported at the right position. Because on RPG Maker XP, when you teleport to another map, your X and Y position change. So if we don't teleport the follower as well, their position will be wrong. And that's why also when you have fogs in your map and you teleport to another exterior map, the fogs change its position. It's not smooth. That's because of this property. And then we have this function. Not this one. You have a lot. Yeah. We have this one on warp end, so it's called at the end of the warp. That means that the player is actually on the new map. So we test that we had to leave surf because we don't know. Maybe the maker has made the limit of the map being a surf tile and the other map is not a surf tile. We have if the player was outside and is still outside, or we force the reposition of the follower position. We basically use this variable created later. And then we set the position of the followers and they are at the right position. And there's a lot of stuff like updating the roaming Pokemon and stuff like that. Yeah, you can do a lot of things. For example, there is the processus that is called every frames that updates the time tone system and the particles. And there's another one that is interesting. This one that is called every frame, and this one allows us to show the key bidding UE. So this way you can change the key in game by pressing F1. So edge. Can we save the particle between two maps to redraw them, or are we obligated to load the map with the chunk system? Right now, when you warp, the particle sprites are disposed. Because if you want to teleport the particles, you need to store the position of each particles and then teleport them on the new map. And that's a real complex system. I think it will be better to wait the chunk system for that, because with the chunk system, the X and Y position will be global. So when you are on 0, 0 on X and Y, you will be on a certain map and not in a lot of maps. You will not share the same coordinates for every maps. So basically, if you are on 32, 0, you will be on another map. Or you can be on the same map if the map has two chunks. That depends. But thanks to that, we won't have to remove the particles. We won't have to dispose the particles, and then we don't have to do any calculation between warp to reposition the particles. The best thing to do is to prevent having particles in the warp zones. This way, you don't have issue right now. Okay, and voilà for the scheduler. We have a lot of possibilities, and we can use that to execute code. I can dig in the theory a bit later if you want. And I think, yeah, now it's the time for Q and A, so you can ask anything you want. I will check on Discord if there is any questions, because I don't see them. No, there's no questions. Okay, so if you have any question, you have 35 minutes. And even if you didn't understand something, you can ask also. If something wasn't clear during this hour, you can re-ask. And that can be any type of question about script, or maybe sharing scripts or stuff like that. Or that can be an actual question on PSDK. That can also work, as long as I can answer anything. Okay. So the simplest script to analyze in order to learn Ruby. On PSDK, let's check. I think the easiest one would be the script, like, not this one, the Pokédex, because it creates a module, it creates a class, it uses basic logic, so you see you have basically numbers and arrays of numbers or Boolean. You define some methods, so you see in PSDK the enable method just enable the switch, and the one that tells you if the Pokédex is enabled just enable the show you the switch value. You have the values, the return value, but with the a better name. So you see you can just return a instance variable, and you have some other function that gives you the number of time you captured a species. So you see there that we allow symbols, so we make a condition to retrieve the right ID, and then we return the value. The other scripts that can be interesting to analyze would be, I would say this one, or anyone. We define a data structure. Yeah, I should explain that. And we also define we call that singleton methods on the class. So you see there, those methods will be called like it said there. It will be gameDataPokemon.name and not gameDataPokemon.new.name, which is different. And there is something that can be interesting is this website, HackerRank. So you see on Ruby, I'm testing it. Sometimes I do some practice. So you should go on this website. You have a lot of exercise. It explains very well an exercise. If you want, I can show you. So continue practice. So we have their array initialization, the best. So it tells you what is an array. It shows you how to create an array. So an array with one value. An array with two values that are 10. So that's what we used in the Pokédex. An array with the number of Pokémon that contains 0. Show you this. So basically, I didn't write this version on the Pokédex because it's too long and too indeterminate. And then initialize true variable as explained in the problem statement. I won't do this because that's the hardest part of this. Sometimes you don't understand what they want. But there is a discussion if you want, and they discussed about it. So you see, here is the solution. Okay. Next. Yeah, you can do that, but you create two objects instead of one. Where am I on the Alpha 25 development? Basically, I can show you. I can start a battle. Okay, you see it's a double battle. I can switch a Pokémon. And I can use a move. Not all move, but I can use some. And that's all. The damage calculation formula has been programmed. So all the abilities related to damage calculation can be modified or added. And the action ordering has been done. And I don't know if I made the accuracy check, but I will make a topic about that. Because there's a lot of things to do and you have to know how it works. Maybe I can do a stream for that. And then how the UI script works. So this one is pretty important. So as I said, there is the gameplay. There the gameplay module. So every scene will inherit from gameplay by base clean update. So as it said in the commentary, with this class, you will only need to define update moves, update inputs, update graphics, and stuff like that, and not define the main function that says graphics.transition, and then loop do while send is true, then update. So you don't have to write all of this. All you have to write is the creation of the scene, so initializing the state variables. In this part, you shouldn't create any sprite. You can do this, but you shouldn't. In this part, we have the method creates graphics that is always called by gameplay.base. So it's called basically before graphic.transition, and that's where you will create the graphics. So the first thing is create viewport. Create viewport. That's correct, like this. And this one will create the viewport. There is a default function that creates the main viewport. But if you want two viewports, let's say you are making a DS script, a DS version of PSDK, I say, all the viewports, dev create viewport. So You don't need to create again the main viewport because that's always the same. So you call the default function and then you create sub viewport equal viewport dot create. So you call it sub and then you give a z coordinate, let's say 10,000, and that's all. You have created a second viewport. That is, let's say, the second screen. And the real important thing is that the variables of the viewport end with the name viewport. This way, you don't have to write the dispose method. It will be automatically disposed. And when a viewport is disposed, all its sprites are disposed. This includes text, window, sprite, shapes, and stuff like that. So you just need to create the graphics, create the viewport, if you need to do this, and then write the update inputs. So this one is called when it's possible to update to check the input states. So basically, if you display a message in your scene. If you display a message, there's no call of update inputs and no call of update most, but update graphics will be called anyway. I think full viewport will work, but it's better to use a sneak case. Update to update everything, gameplay is the logic and UIs is the graphics. Totally, gameplay is the logic. It tells what you need, so you want to display the Pokemon information. You create the UI component for that. At least you initialize the UI component for that in the viewport. So in the menu, we need a background and the buttons. So we tell we need the I don't know mesh buttons. And there's too much code. That's why VS Studio Code is better. You can do this. Okay, so we need the number of image index button, and it will create the button. So image indexes is basically a function that translates the index of the button in the image. And the UI is for the definition of how the sprite should look like, putting aside some specific case like blurring the background. Because if you use it only once, it's not useful to create a whole script for that. But there, we use it at least 7 times. So we need to create a class for that, and that goes in the UI module. And also the UI module see everything from UI, so it's better. And I will just end with the logic. If I forgot stuff, yeah, you see there I redefined the main end function, so that's called at the end of main, and I redefined it because I need to save the last index in the menu to make sure that when I will open the menu again, I will be on the same option. But most of the time, you don't need to define this function, so you don't need to define it. And yeah, there's also some specific stuff. You see that we have an index variable that has the last index value, or zero if we are outside of the possible index. And in the update inputs, instead of writing if input up, then add one to remove one to index and then do stuff. If input down, then add one to index and do stuff. We have created a function in PSDK that is that index changed. So we give the name of the instance variable, the button that gives minus one to index, the button that gives minus plus one to the index. And then the max value of index. This one is rotative. That means that it will do 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, and if you go in the other order, it will be 2, 1, 0, 3, 2, 1, 0, 3. And there's another one that is with the bang, I think, and this one is not rotative. It's bound. So if you are at 0, you can go anywhere else than 0. And this function obviously returns a boolean when the index actually changed. So you play the cursor issue and you update the buttons, which is optimized because instead of updating the button each frame, which will cost a lot of memory, I will say, you just update them when the index change. And you see that makes the size of the function really low, really tiny, I will say. And then the update mouse is a bit specific. It's a mouse update, and then we have the update graphics that is updating the entering animation, the quitting animation. So that's when the button comes and it blurs, and when we quit, I think. I don't know what it does when we quit. And if we don't do any of those two things, we just update all the buttons to make sure that the icon moves. But that's not the same update. This update is just about updating the sprite, and the other update is about updating the state of the buttons, which is different. So, and in the UI mono in the UI, I think I already shown the thing, but if you want to see it again, ask me. Okay. Okay. So if I answered everything, we can stop the streaming. And if you have a last question, ask it now. Or in the next stream. Yes, that's yes, that's a shame, but the problem is that they are probably not on the same time zone. They cannot probably write on the chat, but that's not an issue. There will be a rediffusion, and this will help them anyway, because right now there's no tutorial for English people in scripting in PSDK and stuff like that. We already have some in French because I made them, but that's all. Pré-programmé soft. Are you tech talking about designing the UI with a software? I think that depends because you need to have a yeah, like like this one. Yeah, I think can be done. Will be yeah, a UI creator. The most The problem will be the pre-visualization, I think, because it's hard to create a GUI inside BSDK, and it's hard to display how it should look like in BSDK outside of BSDK. So we need to find a compromise. But basically, if we define the most basic things, like create with the Sprite stacks, we have a lot of basic things. That can be easy, I think. Yeah, I think that can be easy to do. Some kind. We should check in the future, because yeah, we can even create a scene that can be doable, I think, with a bit of code, obviously. But basically, when you press button A, do this is really easy to implement in an eventing system, I will say, for example. So yeah. Yeah, that would be cool for those who are afraid of programming. But the problem is finding people who has time to do that. Because doing this is not really a hard task, but yeah. Thank you too for coming to the live. And see you next time, I hope. Bye. You're welcome. See you.